Have you ever wondered how some runners drop huge chunks of time of their marathon PBs, seemingly overnight? Many people think it's just about talent or luck. But the truth is that there's actually science-backed strategies that can completely transform your training, and I'm going to show you exactly how I plan to use them to crush my own marathon PB. I'm Göran, a lifelong runner, coach and physiotherapist, and I've helped thousands of runners over the years to improve. And I've spent weeks poring over studies, finding tweaks that actually makes a difference. And it turns out that when I trained for and ran my last marathon in 2:57, I failed with 4 out of the 8 things I will talk about today. So if you want to run faster, stick around, because the training tweaks I will share with you today can cut minutes of your finish time. The first thing I will talk about may seem obvious and was what I was just out there trying to do. But hear me out, because there is no way around this topic if you want to become a great distance runner, no matter if you're running the marathon or shorter distances. Because in a way it's pretty simple, you run more and you get faster. And some researchers actually made a massive Strava analysis of 120,000 marathoners, checking their average running volume in the last 16 weeks leading up to the marathon. And here you can see how they put the runners in different groups depending on their finish time. And here you can see this correlation so clear. The more the runners average in weekly volume, the last miles leading into the race, the faster the finish times were. And this is one of the things and the main thing that I severely failed with myself leading into my last marathon. Due to a lot of sickness and injury problems leading into the race, I simply ran way too little. But even though this may seem really obvious to most, it is way easier said than done. Because in order to run a lot, you gotta do it in a smart way and have a really steady progression over time. Because if it's one thing I know way too well being a physiotherapist, is that the easiest way to destroy your training with a major injury is to do too much too soon. So my plan is to build up to around 90 kilometers per week over the next 4 months and do it with a really steady progression. And also include lots of easy miles to avoid injury. Because it's not about one heroic week or one insane training session that will make a huge difference. It's about being consistent and running a lot of mileage over time that rewires your physiology for endurance and basically adapts your whole body to become a distance running machine. This topic is sort of a new and hyped training game changer that more and more people are adapting into their training regime. Because new research shows that heat training, meaning you train in very warm climate or simply just put on a lot of clothes and get your core temperature higher during your training, can boost your blood plasma by around 6.5% in just 10 days. And also significantly improve your VO2 max. And getting heat adapted and doing this kind of heat training is of course especially important if you're going to compete in warm conditions. But even in colder conditions, it can clearly give you a great boost and some of the same effects as you get from altitude training, with increased number of red blood cells that is the vehicle to transport oxygen to your muscles. And the more oxygen you can transport into your muscles, the faster you will be able to run. This is another thing that I didn't incorporate at all before my last marathon, but I'm really curious to try it out, so my plan is to start experimenting with doing 1 to 2 heat training workouts each week, either on the stationary bike or on the treadmill with lots of clothes on, to hopefully give me some free bonus gains that will help me out on race day. But be careful if you want to try this out, because overdoing it and overheating can of course be dangerous. If you're only going to remember one thing from this video, it should be that you get good at what you train at. And in marathon, that means running a lot at or close to your goal marathon pace. And also try to keep other things similar. Run at a similar surface and with similar shoes that you plan to race with. A study that highlights this well is this 6-week randomized trial, where they compared continuous training at 70 to 75% of the maximal aerobic speed with interval training at 95 to 110% of your maximal aerobic speed. And the results showed that the continuous training improved the running economy at those lower intensity that they trained at, while the higher paced interval training did not enhance running economy at those lower intensity. So this highlights that the specific pace of training leads to specific adaptations. So if I want to run a 3:54 per kilometer for a sub 2:45 marathon on race day, I need to train a lot at or close to that pace. So I'm planning to do regular tempo runs at marathon pace and long runs with sections where I will be running at my goal pace. And obviously this is another thing I failed massively at during my last marathon build-up with my general lack of specific training. So a huge room for improvement there. Some years ago, I honestly thought that fast running shoes were all marketing hype and that it really didn't make that big of a difference. But then studies started coming out showing that these kind of new modern super shoes with a carbon plate inside of them and this really lightweight midsole materials that give a lot of energy return actually do improve running performance. In many studies showing about a 3-4% boost in the running economy. And this should mean that most people could save minutes using these in a marathon compared to a more traditional racing shoe. So the tech side of running science I for sure got right in my last marathon. I really can't complain about not having enough good gear at least. In my last marathon I ran with these, the Nike Alpha Fly 3, but some recent studies suggest that even faster running shoes have hit the market. So I will for sure try out some different shoes and also see what works best for me, because as with everything, it's an individual thing. You need to find what works for you. But don't make the mistake of thinking that you just have to buy an expensive pair of running shoe and then you will run super fast. Because all of the other things I talk about today are mostly free and they still make a bigger difference than just buying a pair of shoes. But if you want to optimize everything and run as fast as possible and a fast shoe motivates you to put in more and better training, I think it's a good thing with these new modern super shoes. But what about other running tech like heart rate monitors and GPS watches? Do they actually make you run faster? Well, there's a recent really interesting study published in the American Journal of Sports Medicine that answers exactly that question. They followed 220 recreational runners and split them into two different groups. One used wearables that gave real-time feedback on things like running speed and stride, and the other group had no real-time feedback during their workouts. And the results are pretty eye-opening. The runners who used the real-time feedback had 47% lower injury rate compared to those that didn't use any feedback from their watches. And not only were there fewer injuries, the injuries that did happen were also less severe. So the key takeaway from this study is that the runners who got the live feedback during their training were much better at avoiding the too hard easy runs that's so common. And this meant that they stuck to their planned intensities, recovered properly and could train more consistently. Three things that are absolutely crucial if you want to get the most out of yourself during a marathon build-up. So that's one of the reasons why I'm really excited to have Corals as a part of my journey towards the Valencia Marathon and also as a sponsor to this video. And one thing that I really nailed during my last marathon attempt was my pacing throughout the race. A lot thanks to the Corals Pace Pro paired with their heart rate monitor and the pod. This setup gave me incredibly accurate real-time data on my pace and intensity throughout the whole race, which allowed me to stay perfectly dialed into my fitness level and not overdoing it early in the race and execute my pacing strategy just the way I wanted to. So during the race I also used the nutrition alert feature on my Corals watch to remind me exactly when to take my gels, It made a huge difference not having to think about fueling at all. I could just focus on my running and wait for my watch to basically tell me that it was time to take in more carbs. But it's of course not only during the race I will have a huge advantage from using my watch. The Course watch and app makes it super easy to plan workouts and hit the exact paces and intensities I want to do in each workout. So a big thanks to Coros for supporting my channel and creating these great products for us runners. Speaking about taking gels during the race, this next topic is another really interesting thing where science breakthroughs in the last couple of years have really made a change in people's ability to perform in all endurance sports where you are active for a prolonged time. Because although it has been a known thing for a long time that taking carbohydrates through sports drinks or gels makes a huge difference in your performance on longer events, where you simply run out of glycogen storage in your muscles and liver if you don't refuel during your effort. But still, compared to what current research suggests, most runners, including myself, have been under-fueling a lot, taking in too little carbs, essentially. So modern sports nutrition products also allow you to take in more carbs without getting stomach problems during the race. Research have now shown that runners should aim for 60 to 90 grams of carbs per hour during races lasting over 2 hours. And the latest evidence suggests even more, up to 120 grams of carbs, if you train your stomach to handle it. But this is actually one of the things I must give myself a passing grade for during my last marathon, taking in around 75 grams of carbs per hour. But if I train on taking in even more than that in training, maybe I can use the carb intake even more to my favor in my next marathon and push a bit closer to at least 90 grams per hour. Most runners, including myself, have made the mistake of going out way too fast and having to slow down during the race. The science is pretty clear. Even pacing or slight negative splits are the most efficient way to run and lead to the best marathon outcomes. Positive splits, where you slow down dramatically, cost huge amounts of time and are almost always a sign that you simply went out way too hard. And as mentioned earlier, this is another thing that I managed to nail in my last marathon, running a slight negative split with the first half marathon at 1:29:25 and finishing in 2:57:28. And doing slight negative splits is something I will do my absolute best to also manage to do in Valencia. Strength training was another thing I massively failed at in my build-up towards my last marathon, and I think it is such an important part if you want to give yourself the best opportunity to perform. It doesn't have to take up that much time, but can still lead to great performance improvements. Studies shown that just 1 to 2 short weekly sessions of heavy resistance strength training improves running economy by 2 to 4%. Without adding unwanted muscle mass. So my plan when it comes to strength work is to twice a week do a strength session focusing on heavy squats, deadlifts, and running relevant single leg exercises. Finally, tapering well, meaning that you ease off your training enough and in a good way leading into the race, is such an easy way to get a free boost into your performance on race day. And this I also managed to do quite well before my last marathon after putting a lot of thought into it. And I actually made a whole separate video about this so important part of getting the best out of your body on race day. To learn more about that, you can watch this video here. And a huge thanks to Coros again for creating these great products. There's a link in the description to check out all of their great running watches. Train smart, have fun, and I'll see you in the next video.